Hello everyone, I'm Elisabetta Manea, I'm a marine ecologist and I work at the University of Venice. With my research work, I'm supporting the implementation of the Maritime Spatial Planning Directive in Europe and the incorporation of the ecosystem-based approach in the planning process. I'm going to talk to you about the marine spatial planning, theory and key steps. Marine spatial planning is a practical way to establish a more rational organization of the use of marine space to avoid conflicts between uses and to limit the impact on the environment. Marine spatial plan aims at balancing demands for development with the need to protect marine ecosystems and to achieve social, economic, and environmental objectives in an open and planned way. In fact, its main purpose is to promote sustainable development and to identify the use of marine space for different sea uses, as well as to manage spatial uses and conflicts in marine areas. Maritime spatial planning also aims at identifying and encouraging multipurpose uses, finding synergies between different sectors. The planning process should be comprehensive, also considering long-term changes due to climate change. The 72% of our planet is covered by oceans and seas that offer an outstanding number of resources. Thus, managing the sea is fundamental. The exploitation of marine resources and space represent both old and new frontiers, and it must be ruled in a way that all sectors are coordinated and grow without exacerbate the condition of the marine environment. Of all this marine space, the 39% falls within exclusive economic zones. These are marine waters under national jurisdiction, for which the countries are called to build their marine special plans. 61% of the ocean, instead, is high sea, not being under any national sovereignty, and their management is still mainly undefined. MSP could represent the opportunity to favor the establishment of transnational collaborations and agreements to manage this wide portion of our planet. MSP can limit conflicts and create synergies between different sectors. Conflicts among activities and between them and the environment weaken the ability of the ocean to provide the necessary benefits upon which we depend. Being anticipatory, MSP can avoid late reaction to unwanted events. MSP encourage investment by ensuring predictability, transparency, and clearer standards. MSP cannot be successful if not at least some funds are made available for doing it. Being a public process and being based on principles that build on public trust, MSP can effectively attract funds. Thanks to its multi-sectoral approach, MSP can enhance coordination among administrations in individual countries through the use of a single tool to reconcile the development of a range of maritime activities, ensuring greater simplicity and lower cost. Being a tool that aims to achieve many goals, both socioeconomic and environmental, MSP can increase cross-border cooperation between European and potentially non-European countries that share the same marine space. By anticipating conflicts and by promoting the sustainable use of marine resources, MSP protects the environment by early detection of impacted opportunities for multipurpose use of space. These are the main characteristics that mark MSP. Marine spatial planning is place-based because it is focused on marine areas that people can recognize, understand, relate to, and care about. It is participatory because it aims at involving multi-level stakeholders during all the process. MSP is multi-objective and integrated since it includes all the sectors and balances both socioeconomic and environmental goals through the adoption of a multidisciplinary and holistic approach. MSP is strategic and future-oriented, being anticipatory and focused on future scenarios. It is ecosystem-based because it aims at preserving marine resources and ensuring their sustainable exploitation. MSP is continuing and adaptive because it learns from the experience and through monitoring and evaluation processes. Managed spatial planning can offer effective solutions for the achievement of a wide range of planning objectives. Many are the aspects that ensure an effective MSP process, making it comprehensive and operational. For instance, the planning and the governance of the seed space should be harmonized and coordinated between sectors, administrative levels, and across national boundaries. Ecological quality standards should be agreed and made operational, measurable, and regularly monitored. Environmental monitoring should be agreed in order to produce oriented and comparable information related to the quality status of the sea. Environmental data needs to be regularly translated into spatial and planning information. They should be planning-oriented, being informative for the aims of the plan. Coherent environmental, social, and economic quality objectives and standards are developed with broad participation and transparency. Areas critical for biodiversity and productivity need to be identified and protected via well-managed networks of marine protected areas. This should be done before setting the plan. Within protected areas, harmful uses will be excluded via zoning to strengthen biodiversity, resilience, and productivity. Managed spatial planning adopts an objective-based approach, meaning that the starting step of the process is the identification of why we need the plan. During all the process, any collected information, all the data gathered, and any analysis carried out have to be oriented toward the achievement of the planning goals established at the very beginning of the process. The most recognized and widely adopted methodological approach to MSP is the UNESCO-IOC step-by-step approach toward ecosystem-based management. This is a guide primarily intended for professionals responsible for the planning and management of the sea. It can be a useful tool at any level and spatial scale of planning, national, regional, local. The methodological approach developed and proposed by this guide is composed of 10 main phases that lead the planner to perform actions and to follow consequential and logical steps to achieve the intended objectives of managed spatial plan. Here I'm going to summarize the main phases of the MSP process, explaining their meaning. Because managed spatial planning is a future-oriented process, the first main phase of the process is that of visioning and problem scoping. Four are the questions that need an answer to start building a plan and are: where are we now? Where do we want to go? What resources do we need? How do we plan to get there? It is fundamental, in fact, to define the objectives of the plan and to have clear in mind why there is the need to develop a marine spatial plan. This will enable to stay coherent throughout the process in relation with the defined planning objectives. Specifying MSP goals and objectives is essential to stay focused and tailor the MSP efforts toward achieving results. Typically, the goals and objectives should be derived from the problems and conflicts identified in the area that need to be planned. The definition of the existing conditions is the second phase to be highlighted. Detailed maps with real spatial data are relevant means to drive the analysis of the present conditions of the marine area of interest. In addition to the definition of the jurisdictional boundaries in the area, three are the categories of spatial information that are needed: biological and ecological, those related with the existing human activities, and those related with the oceanographic and physical environmental features. All the collected data have to be relevant for the plan. They have to be up-to-date and reliable, and selected and harmonized for being comparable. From the definition of the existing conditions, it is possible to analyze the conflicts that are present in the area in terms of spatial overlap of uses and negative impact on the environment. The third phase he described is the definition of future conditions and scenarios analysis. Because money spatial planning is a future-oriented activity, the analysis of the future conditions is fundamental for the achievement of the planning objectives. This phase should be structured in different steps. The first one is projecting current trends in space and time of the existing human uses. The second one is estimating spatial and temporal requirements for new demands of ocean space. The third one is identifying possible alternative future scenarios for the planning area. And the last one is selecting the preferred spatial sea use scenario. As an example, one future scenario to consider will be the so-called business as usual or trend scenario that illustrates how the MSP area will look if present conditions continue without new management interventions. Alternative spatial sea use scenarios can illustrate how the management area might look when human activities are redistributed based on new goals and objectives. The spatial sea use scenarios allow to anticipate potential future opportunities, conflicts, or synergies for the area. After the scenario analysis, there is the need to elaborate the planning measures. These measures enable the achievement of the planning goals and objectives. The planning measures can be of different nature. The input measures are the ones that specify the inputs to human activities in a marine area and rule the possible effort in terms of marine resources exploitation. The process measures are the ones that specify the nature of the production process of human activities and rule the way and means with which the resources have to be exploited. The output measures are the measures that specify the outputs of human activities in a marine area and rule the amount of resources that can be exploited or the amount of secondary products that can be delivered in the environment. And finally, the spatial and temporal measures are the ones that specify where and when human activities can be carried out in a marine area. This phase is followed by the implementation of the plan. At this step, the planning phase should be finished, and the spatial management and zoning plan should be set. This consists in a comprehensive document that provides the strategic framework for the marine spatial plan decisions. In the implementation phase, the governmental and sectoral institutions should approve and ensure compliance with the management plan. They should coordinate with each other and operationalize real actions to implement and enforce it. Throughout the process, it's fundamental the involvement of key stakeholders. This is true for different reasons. The most important is the fact that the marine plan should reflect as many expectations and needs of the area, as well as try to solve the existing conflicts and problems. Stakeholders can highly contribute to the building of the knowledge framework to develop the planning proposal. They may help in generating new options and solutions by working on mutually agreed collaborations. Moreover, they are the ones that will enforce and implement the management plan. Finally, the phase of monitoring and evaluation of the plan is the one that allows the evaluation of the effectiveness and performance of the plan, leading to an adaptive management process. In fact, the planning cycle should be adaptive and circular. This means that fundamentally the identification of adequate indicators that should be continuously monitored to provide managers and stakeholders with indications of the progress achieved to reach the management goals. This phase consists on assessing the state of the system that is managed and on measuring the performance of the management measures. The revision of the plan brings to a continuous improvement of the plan, through the application of a learning by doing approach. It is important to remember that we can only plan and manage the human activities and their development in the marine space, but we cannot do the same with the marine environment and its ecosystems. In fact, marine ecosystems need to be preserved and exploited in a sustainable way. For this reason, it is fundamental the application of the ecosystem-based approach to achieve the final outcome of marine spatial planning, which is the socioeconomic growth through the use of marine space and resources, and contemporarily the protection of the marine environment and its components. In Module 8, we will talk about the ecosystem-based approach and its importance within the planning context. Here you can find all the references that were cited in this module. I invite you to deepen the themes we have addressed in this lesson.